बिस्मिल्लाह रहमान रहीम, अस्सलाम वालेकुम। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस सैम्पलिंग एंड इट्स टाइप। नाउ देर आर वेरियस क्वेश्चंस बिफोर वी रियली स्टार्ट दिस लेक्चर, दैट व्हाट इज सैम्पलिंग एंड व्हाई डू वी थिंक देर इज अ नीड फॉर सैम्पलिंग। सैम्पलिंग इज समटाइम द ओनली सोल्यूशन। सैम्पलिंग मीन्स व्हेन वी टेक अ पीस ऑफ समथिंग और अ पार्ट ऑफ समथिंग and on the basis of that part we can judge the quality or the characteristics of the whole. So for example, if you want to measure the amount of hemoglobin in someone, what we do, we take a small blood sample and we do the maths, and based on that calculation we provide the results that okay, this is going to be the amount of RBCs or hemoglobin in that person. So we cannot drain all the blood. And similarly, if a company wants to test that whether the airbags are working in their car or not, so what they will do, that they will randomly select some vehicles and they crash test them, and they will see that what are the results. They cannot crash test every vehicle to see if the airbag is working. And there are a lot of other examples. So let's start with the sample. So the word sample is used in our daily life activities. A sample is a subset or some part of a larger whole. A larger whole could be anything out of which the sample is taken. A complete group of entities sharing some common characteristics or common set of characteristics in a population. In other words, the totality out of which the sample is drawn is referred to as population. Now, this is very important. Sometimes there is a target population also. If we want to take or if we want to study the diabetic population and we expect that our study is going to help those who are suffering from either type 1 or type 2 diabetes, then that is going to be our target population. So the population is any group of people or anything that is desired about which you are going to conduct your research, and you are going to apply your results to that target population. Why sample? Because it saves cost, labor and time. Applied research projects usually have budget and time constraints. Of course, when we plan the research and when we plan the objective, it has to be SMART, S-M-A-R-T. It has to be specific, it has to be measurable, achievable, it has to be realistic and time bound. So these are the objectives that on the basis of this, we have to design our research or studies. So of course, the time and the budget or the economy is the biggest constraint. So since sample can have, you know, it can help you save some financial cost as well as time. So therefore, to go for a study, sample is pragmatic. It is very essential or it is important. Of course, a researcher investigating a population with an extremely small number of population elements may elect to conduct a study on the total population. For example, if there is a rare condition or rare disease, let's say we want to investigate the effects of physical therapy in one of the very rarest condition. For example, let's say arthrogryposis multiplex congenita, which is very rare, not way too much common. So in that, we need to maybe go for the complete population rather than the sample, because cost, labor and time constraints are relatively insignificant. For example, if we have 10 cases or 2 cases or 5 cases of a condition, then we can go for selecting all the ones. So quality management and supervision. Professional field workers are a scarce commodity. Of course, it is difficult to find trained staff and people. So in a large study, rather than employing less qualified staff, it may be advised to do a sample study and employ highly qualified professionals, field worker. those who know how to conduct the research and what are the norms and things like that. So you need to take a sample to have a test or to have a pilot. At the same time, it may be easier to manage a small group of, and produce quality information, and supervision, record keeping, training and so forth would all be more difficult in a very large study. So it is imperative and it is essential that we need to go for sampling. Sometimes the sample, it provides us accurate and reliable results. Another major reason is that, you know, it is more accurate sometime and more reliable as compared to the whole of the population. When the elements of population are highly homogeneous, any homogeneous means they are similar in characteristics, samples are highly representative of the population, and samples may be more accurate than the census, means going for the whole population. In a census study of large population, there is a great likelihood of non-sampling errors. Of course, there are some other errors, or there is a lot of variation also. In a survey, mistakes may occur that are unrelated to the selection of people in the study. For example, a response may be coded incorrectly, or the keyboard operator might make the data entry error. Interviewer mistakes, tabulation errors, and other non-sampling errors may increase during census because of increased volume of work. The large amount of data is exposed of having non-sampling errors as compared to a small sample. If we want to manage, let's say, 1 million people's data, it would be really difficult and chances of error would be more as compared to if we are going to manage only 1,000 patients' data. So in sample, increased accuracy is possible because the field work and tabulation of the data can be closely supervised than would be possible in a census. Census, in Urdu we say mardam shumari, any complete enumeration of the population. Why sample? Now, sampling may be the only way. Like I told you before, there are a lot of other examples also, like firecrackers. If I want to test whether my firecrackers are working or not, I would not go for lighting up all of them. So determine the period of study. Interviewing every element of a large population without sampling requires a lot of time, so maybe a year or more. So in such a long period study, even the seasonal variation may influence the response pattern of the respondents. For example, if you want to study upper respiratory tract infection or irritation, so it would be more prominent or prevalent in some seasons, in, for example, spring, because of pollination and other factors, and it may not be way too much prevalent in summers. So these are the terminologies that we use commonly: element, population, target population, sampling, sampling frame error, sampling unit, observation unit, parameter, statistics, and sampling error. Let's see what is an element. So an element is the unit about which information is collected and which provides the basis of analysis. In our case, it can be a single patient. So typically, in survey research, elements are people or certain types of people. For example, a patient from diabetes or low back pain or neck pain or something like that. So it is that unit about which information is collected, and that provides the basis of analysis, and it can be a person, group, families, organizations, or anything at all. Population is theoretically specified aggregation of study elements. So if you have a collection of study elements, then it will make a population. Like I told you before, if we are going to apply our results, or if we want to study the diabetic peoples, so the diabetic population in Pakistan or in my city is going to be my target population or my population. So it is the translating the abstract concept into workable concept. For example, let us look at the study of college students. Theoretically, who are the college students? So they might include students registered in government colleges or private colleges, or students of intermediate classes and or graduate classes, students of professional colleges and non-professional colleges, and many other variations. So in this way, the pool of all available element is population. Now, target population. Out of the conceptual variations, what exactly the researcher wants to focus on, this may be also called as a target population. So target population is the complete group of specific population elements relevant to the research project. Like I told you, if in the diabetic population, we want to study only the type 2 diabetes, so now the type 2 will become our target population. Although type 1 is also diabetic, but based on our criteria, it has to be removed. So this will be the population that we actually took into our study. So target population may be called as the survey population, that is the aggregation of elements from which the survey sample is actually selected. At the outset of the sampling process, it is vitally important to carefully define the target population so the proper source from which the data are collected can be identified. For example, I say, okay, I'm taking type 2 diabetic patients, but only those who are having peripheral neuropathy. Now, in the type 2 diabetes, I am also looking for those who have this condition, peripheral neuropathy. So now type 2 diabetics with peripheral neuropathy is going to be my target population. So it has to be refined, and like previously discussed, when you are going to take the sample, it is based on certain criteria. So this is exactly referring to that population. Now, the process of using a small number of items or parts of a larger population to make conclusions about the whole population is sampling, and it enables the researcher to estimate unknown characteristics of the population. Now, there are various ways in which we can, you know, select the sample, and we are going to discuss those types also. But the sample means, for example, if we cooked some rice, we just want to test, or we just want to take a bite out of it and to assess the quality, or to assess the stage of preparation, or to assess anything at all. So for that, we need to take a sample, and then we can make appropriate adjustments. Sampling frame. Now, it is the actual practice the sample will be drawn from a list of population elements that is often different from the target population that has been defined. It can be, again, it can be more specific than the sampling target population. Now, a sampling frame is the list of elements from which the sample may be drawn. Like I told you previously, that in type 2 diabetics, we can go for peripheral neuropathy, and then we can also go for something else. A simple example could be listing of all college students meeting the criteria of target population and who are enrolled on a specific date. A sampling frame is also called as the working population because it provides the list that can be worked with operationally. And we can somehow, even in those in diabetic type 2 diabetes, we were talking about peripheral neuropathy, and then in the peripheral neuropathy, we could say, okay, those who are having this grade of peripheral neuropathy. There can be sampling frame errors. The frame error occurs when certain sample elements are excluded, or when the entire population is not accurately represented in the sampling frame. So it is just like you are taking a picture and something of prime importance is out of your picture. So the error that occurs when certain sample elements are not listed or available and are not represented in the sampling frame. So maybe let's say you wanted to study about type 2 and type 1 diabetes altogether, but the area you selected, for example, you said, I will work on, let's say, block A. Maybe in the block A, there is no patient of type 1 diabetes. All of the patient, let's say, are from the type 2. So now the sampling frame is wrong, because you could have worked before to know the facts and figures, that what is the distribution of the population or your target population in the community, and then you could have developed your sampling frame, or sometime you can broaden your your sampling frame also. Sampling unit. A sampling unit is the element or set of elements considered for selection in some stage of sampling. sampling may be done on a single stage or in multiple stage. Like for example, we want to just like let's say these cricket matches, they go for the regular matches based on the score, they go to quarterfinals or semifinals and even the finals. So similarly, there can be one stage of selection or there can be multiple stages of selection also. So in a simple single stage sample, the sampling units are same as the elements. So they will not change. But in more complex samples, however, different levels of sampling units may be employed. For example, a researcher may select a sample from Mohalla in a city and then select a sample of households from selected Mohallas. Yani we will only take these houses, and finally may select a sample of adults from those selected households. Yani we are not going to include the children's or the geriatric populations or the old age. We are going to only select the adults from the specific houses. So then the sampling units of these three stages of sampling are respectively Mohalla, household and adults, for which the three are the elements. Now more specifically, the terms primary sampling unit and secondary sampling units and final sampling units would be used to designate the successive stages. So you can sometime refer to this as stage 1, stage 2 and stage 3 also. Observation unit. An observation unit or unit of data collection is an element or aggregation of elements from which the information is collected. Now we took a single element or unit, and then from that element or from that unit we are going to take the data. Often the unit of analysis and unit of observation are the same, yani it will be the individual person, but this needs not to be the case. Thus the researcher may interview heads of households to observation units to collect information about every member of household, the unit of analysis. Yani it is indirect data, it is not direct data collection, it is indirect data collection. So we may not take direct information from one person, rather we can take information from another person, and then it could be indirect method of questioning or interviewing, or it can be sometime in certain aspects it can be the secondary data. Now the parameters. Remember P for population and remember P for parameter. A parameter is the summary description of a given variable in a population. So it is the summary description of a given variable in the population, the mean income of all families in a city and the age distribution of city's populations are the parameters. An important portion of survey research involves the estimation of population parameters on the basis of sample observation. If you want to estimate what is the average daily income of people living in Sadiqabad, Rawalpindi, we could be taking a random sample based on the total number of population that are earning. Of course, we should refer to some statistics that are available beforehand, and then we can, you know, somehow select, let's say 200 people, and then we can have an idea about the estimate of the average wages or daily income of the population. Statistic is the S stand for statistic and S stands for sample. So a statistic is the summary description of given variable in the survey sample. So this relates to the sample, and parameter relates to the population. So it is one and the same thing, just one is applied to the sample and the other is applied to the population. Thus the mean income computed from the survey sample and the age distribution of the sample are the statistics. Yani if we take the same value from the sample, it would be called a statistic, and the very same value for the population will be referred to as parameter. So sample statistics are used to make estimates of the population parameters. So we take this value and we will apply this value to the population, and we will say, okay, this is the estimate of the population. So there can be sampling errors. Probability sampling methods seldom, which refers to random sampling methods if ever provide statistics exactly equal to the parameters that they are used to estimate. Of course, random means there is random chance of error. So sometime the random chance of error can be more than 50 and sometime it can be less than 50. So probability theory, however, permits us to estimate the error to be expected for a given sample. More information to be sought from the professional in the statistics. Of course, you can ask more about the probability theory, or you can watch more videos about the probability theory, that what it states and what is the meaning. If we flip a coin, there was a typical example. If we flip a coin 100 times and the coin is unbiased, according to the probability theory, it says that there are 50% chances of getting the head and 50% chances of getting the tail. Out of 100 times, we will be receiving, or we'll be viewing 50 heads and 50 tails. This is probability theory, but it is not 100% applicable. Maybe there can be very, very, very little or negligible factor, air factor or anything at all that can change the results. So let's come to talk about the types of sampling. There are two types. One is called as the probability and the other is called as non-probability sampling. By the word probability, what I mean is that something that has randomness into it, and non-probability, something that does not have any randomness in it. So in probability sampling, every element in the population has a known non-zero probability of selection. Or sometimes we say that they have equal chances of getting selected, then it is referred to as probability. So the simple random is the best known probability sample in which each member of the population has an equal probability of being selected. Let's say there are 10 people in the class and we want to select only 2 randomly. So one possible method is to take the lottery method. We should write the name or the number of all roll numbers of all the students, and we should shuffle, mix them, and then we can ask someone to take 2 slips out of the lottery, and we can select these 2, and we or anyone else has no involvement in the selection process. Similarly, there are other ways or methods. Sometimes rolling a dice can be done. Sometimes a random number generator software can be used. Sometimes Excel can be used, Microsoft Excel can be used, and some other softwares can also be applied or used to know the randomness. Random samples are most likely to yield a sample that truly represents the population. But again, let's say again that you wanted to select only those who will, let's say that who will be having a particular problem, but you end up selecting randomly those who have no problem. Or let's say you wanted to give something to the poor, but when you selected people randomly without the proper workup, you end up in giving money to the rich also. So there are a lot of examples. In addition, random sampling lets the researcher statistically calculate the relationship between the sample and population, and that is the size of the sampling error. You can, of course, have a sampling error. Sometime a non-statistical definition of sampling error is the derivation or deviation between sample results and population parameters due to the random process. There are chances that you get everything 100% correct, and then even after that, because it is sampling, you wanted to see what is the average hemoglobin level in the females of Islamabad. You took the sample of 500 females, and all of those 500 females were actually having hemoglobin level of 15. But you know in reality that the females would be having anemia, or they would be having low hemoglobin, maybe 11 or 12 in most of the cases. And you selected every female or every element randomly, but there is this sampling error. It might be possible that you have selected, let's say, the data from the Islamabad and at the time of evening, and all those, or let's say in the morning, and those who are working ladies, they are in the offices, and you selected the data from the houses, and only, let's say, the very rich and very healthy and very well-off females were available, and for this reason you were getting the results. So again, you took the elements or the units randomly, but still the time at which the data was taken or the location from which the data was taken could affect your results. And again, it is not 100% representative of the population. So there are some other types of probability sampling. For example, simple random sampling. The simple random sample is both the easiest random sample to understand and the one on which other types are modeled. So in simple random sampling, a research develops an accurate sampling frame, select elements from the sampling frame according to the mathematically random procedure, then locates the exact elements and that was selected for inclusion in the sample. After numbering all elements in the sampling frame, the researcher uses a list of random numbers to decide which elements to select. If you have 500 people, you should write their full name, their father name, so that there is no mix up, and then you should assign a number to them. For example, Dr. Sayyid Ali Hussain, son of Dr. Sayyid Ibrar Hussain, is assigned number 1, and Dr. Iftikhar, son of, let's say, Mr. Iqbal, is assigned number 2, and so on and so forth. Once you have all the numbers, then you can put these numbers into the random software to tell you if you want the software to select only, let's say, 20 out of these 500. It is going to select only the 20 numbers. Now you should see, okay, if it selected number 18, you should see, okay, who is number 18, who is number 27. So just like they do in the TV shows, that they say, okay, seat number 39, you are the winner. So similarly, you have to allocate the number. The researcher can get random numbers from a random number table or computer. A random number, a random starting point should be selected at the outset. And random sampling does not guarantee that every random sample perfectly represents the population. This is what I've been telling you before. Instead, it means the most random samples will be close to the population most of the time, and that one that can calculate the probability of a particular sampling being accurate. So we can try our level best, and it could be more close to the real parameters of the population. The sampling distribution is the key idea that lets a researcher calculate sampling error and confidence interval. Then there is a systematic random sample. There is a process of random sampling based on some system. Systematic random sampling is a simple random sampling with a shortcut for random selection. Again, the first step is to number each element in the sample frame. For example, let's say I remember very good example. Let's say there are 500 x-rays and we want to select only 10 x-rays randomly. What can we do? First, we should take first number randomly, and then based on the kth number, we can select that. How it works, let's see. Instead of using a list of random numbers, researchers calculates a sampling interval, and the interval becomes his or her own quasi-random number selection method. The sampling interval, which is the kth item or kth number, tells the researcher how to select elements from a sample frame by skipping elements in the frame before one of the sample. Sampling intervals are easy to compute. We need to calculate the sample size and the population size. You can think of sample interval as the inverse of sampling ratio. The sampling ratio for 300 names out of 900 would be 33 or 33%. The sampling interval is out of 900 divided by 3, it makes 3. So you should know, if we want to take let's say 20 out of 100, so you will write 100 divided by 20 is equal to 5. So you will select every fifth item, every fifth number. But what would be the first number? This has to be selected randomly. So if the you let's say you take number from 1 to 5, because this is the fifth, so you take number 1 to 5, or let's say from 1 to 100, you wanted to select the first number randomly, and let's say it is the 60. Okay, you start from 60, and now every fifth, 61, 62, 63, 64, and 65th. Now the 65th is your second selection, then 70, then 75, so on and so forth, and you can again roll back to 0 and from 0 to all the way to 60. Then you can have stratified random sampling based on some stratas, based on some characteristics. So when the population is heterogeneous, let's say we have 3 or 4 types of people. We have Asians, we have Americans, we have Africans, and let's say we have Australians. Now these are 4 stratas. These people are different clusters, or these people are different stratas. So if we want to take sample from all of these, there are again 2 most important equal and unequal number of selection. So we are going to discuss that also. When the population is heterogeneous, the use of simple random sample may not produce representative sample. Some of the bigger strata may get over representation, while some of the small ones may entirely be eliminated. Yani if we have 1 million Pakistanis and only 5 or 10 or 20 Africans, so Pakistanis might have over representation and Africans might have under representation in this. So there are 3 reasons why a researcher chooses a stratified random sample. Number 1, to increase the sample statistical efficiency, to provide adequate data for analyzing the various subpopulations, and to enable different research methods and procedures to be used in different stratas. So there can be cluster sampling to select the intact group as a whole, is known as cluster. Selecting the intact group, complete group as a whole, is known as cluster. In cluster sampling, the sampling units contain groups of elements instead of individual members or items in the population. This was just something you can do to get a bit fresh. You can try it. Move your leg in clockwise circle and simultaneously try to draw 6 with your hand. And you are so trying, write it now, aren't you? So you can't. Your legs will change the direction every time you try. Okay, then now you will see the non-probability sampling. In this non-probability sampling, it means that the people have more chances. They don't have equal chances of being selected. So in non-probability sampling, the probability of any particular element of the population being chosen is unknown. We don't know this. The selection of unit is non-probability sampling is quite arbitrary, as the researcher rely heavily on personal judgment. So there is no equal chance of getting selection. There can be a lot of biasness and things like that. So it should be noted that there are no appropriate statistical techniques for measuring sampling errors from a non-probability sample. In non-probability sampling designs, the elements in the population do not have any probabilities attached to their being chosen as a sample subjects. So this means that the findings from the study of sample cannot be confidently generalized to the population. Sometimes non-probability could be the only way to collect data. In this, we have convenience sampling, also called as haphazard or accidental sampling, referred to sample obtaining who are most conveniently available. I went out and I have seen 5 guys and I took the sample from those five, maybe all of them were poor, or all of them were smoker, or all of them are non-smoker. So if I wanted to see how many guys in my city are smoking, I took the sample of 20, and those 20 were living in my street. None of them were a smoker. Can I say that, okay, nobody in this city is smoking? So this refers to a problem with the sampling. So convenience samples are least reliable, but normally the cheapest and easiest to conduct. Convenience sampling is most often used during the exploratory phase of research projects and is perhaps the best way of getting some basic information quickly and efficiently. The purpose of sampling is based on some criteria. When we say that there is an inclusion criteria, let's say type 2 diabetes with polyneuropathy, with that hypertension, with that this age, this gender. So now we will exclude the rest of the population and we will only focus on this, that meets the criteria. So this is called as the purpose of sampling. So it is sometimes referred to as judgmental or expert opinion sample also. Then we can have quota sampling. So we can, you know, allocate a certain amount of quota to some group of people or to some community. So it can be quota sampling. It is very easy to have. It is very common in Pakistan also. So let's say we give equal quota to Punjab and Balochistan, that we will select, okay, we need 10 doctors from each province of Pakistan. So if there are 5 provinces, 10 from each, this is called equal quota or quota sampling. Then there is snowball sampling. Snowball is just like it is a snowball that is shown in the cartoons, that as it rolls, it keeps on getting bigger and bigger and bigger. So it is also called as network or chain sampling or reputational sampling. Let's say we want to work on the population who has sexually transmitted diseases or who have AIDS. So it is very difficult. Or let's say we want to study the females who are using cocaine. Let's say university students who are using cocaine or hashish. So it would be really very difficult to, you know, nobody is going to tell you. So in that particular case, maybe you somehow get one person, and from that person is going to lead you to another person. Okay, I know someone else who also uses hashish or cocaine, and then they can refer to another. So it keeps on growing. So this type of sampling is called a snowball sampling, and it is done for those conditions which are not socially acceptable most commonly, or if there is any social string attached to, or if there is any problem attached to it. So I think that is all from my side. I hope you have a lot of questions. If you have any questions and comments, do let me know. Thank you very much.